Him, and the city lieth four square, and the length is as large as the breadth. And he measured the city with the reed, 12,000 furlongs. A furlong is about 600 feet, which means that this new Jerusalem is approximately 1,500 miles long by 1,500 miles wide by 1,500 miles wide, or 15 miles high. The base of the city should be in comparison to about two-thirds of the size of the United States. And he measured the wall thereof 144 cubits, which is 216 feet high, according to the measure of man. And the building of the wall of it was a jasper, and the city was pure gold, like unto clear glass. And the foundations of the wall of the city were garnished with all manner of precious stones. I'm not going to get into each stone. You can read about it in Revelation chapter 21, verses 11 to 27. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls, and every single gate was of one pearl. And the city, and the street of the city was pure gold, as it were a transparent glass. And John says he saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are the temple of it. And the city had no need of the sun, neither of the moon, to shine in it, for the glory of God did lighten it. And the Lamb is the light thereof. And the nations of them which are saved shall walk in the light of it. And the kings of the earth do bring their glory and honor into it. And the gates of it shall not be shut at all by day, for there shall be no night there, and there shall no wise enter into it anything that defileth, neither whatsoever worketh abomination or maketh a lie, but they which are written in the Lamb's book of life. And this new Jerusalem, it's a prepared place for prepared people. It's a place of gold, place of pearls, precious stones. The size of the city is 1,500 miles high, wide, and long, which means the shape either must be a pyramid or a cube, because it has 12 foundations or levels. In all certainty, it would most likely be take the form of a cube, because God has used this form before in both the altar of burnt offering and the altar of incense. You can read about that in Exodus 27 and 30. The ancient Greeks also regarded the cube as a symbol for perfection. Imagine a huge city in the shape of a cube, 12 levels or floors high, with a 216-foot wall around it. Each floor characterizes a different gem, and the city itself is 1,500 miles high. And so try to imagine John trying to put all this down so people can understand what he's saying. So very interesting that those living on the new earth during that time will have access to the holy city, while the church age saints and all those who have died for him before that time will be its residents. And so it's very interesting. When you look at the correlation of the sun we have today and what this new Jerusalem is going to be like, so I find it really interesting. Because I know that Enoch says, he described a place in the north to northwest part of the sky, space, whatever, and a place of inhabitation where the Lord's people were. And so at the time of Enoch, there really wasn't a lot of dead Lord's people. I mean, there was, you know, it's the beginning of time and stuff. But obviously, people of the Lord had been dying, and there was a place made for them in the north and northwest. And we know that his glory, his throne is set up in the physical sun right now, that his light would obviously reach those who are in his habitation, that we would refer to as heaven right now. So I bet you what if even right now that he himself is with those who are in heaven, who have died and gone to heaven. You'll hear near-death experiences, take it, or, you know, take it as a grain of salt or whatever, whether they're truth or not. Most of them aren't. Some of them are interesting. I had a vision once of heaven myself, and you certainly don't see a physical sun. And so, but you do see light. There's a lot of light. But you don't see a physical sun. So it's either inside something, and we know all the planets and all the hosts of heaven are hollow. So heaven itself could be in a hollow sun. Or in this place Enoch was describing, somewhere in the north or northwest area of space. Either way, I find it interesting that with the New Jerusalem, there's no more separation at all. There's no more sun. There's no more moon. There's no more hosts of heaven, planets, and all that separation. We'll be together with him in this New Jerusalem. And he is the light of it. And so I find that interesting. Sometimes I sit and just dwell on thoughts and things for a long time and hoping he'll reveal more information about it to me, because we know the sun's hollow. Is heaven located in the sun? Is it hollow? Is it someplace else in the north northwest as Enoch described? I don't know, you know. Don't have a definite answer on either. It's just one of those things that make you think. So it's interesting that you even have something to chew on, some meat to chew on. You certainly don't get much meat in the churches today. You know, the scripture that says it's the Lord's joy to conceal a matter and the pride of kings to seek it out. Feels something in that arena. And so he does hide things from people, and it's our job to seek it out, you know, figure out what it is, find out what these hidden truths are, you know. And so I think it's interesting. Yeah. So, but by the time, folks, we even get to the second coming, this new Jerusalem that would be coming down, I find it interesting that during the millennial reign, the kings of the earth will be able to visit, and the people, the residents of the earth, will be able to visit the New Jerusalem, but they won't be able to live there. That's kind of like off limits. Only the Lord's people that have, before the millennial reign type, the ones who have died for him are living there. Those are their habitations, so interesting. And those who make it out alive during the last days of the tribulation period and go into the 1,000 years, and all those born during that time will be able to walk under its light. And so there's no death during that 1,000 years millennial reign. And so there's going to be a huge population here on earth. And so this thing has to be way up above, high enough off of the earth, just to make it feasible for billions of people to be living on the earth. Very, very interesting. I think it's just going to be like the new sun, is the way I see it. It just doesn't burn you. No more pain of being sunburned and skin diseases and stuff. And so I find it interesting. Yeah, it's just my thoughts on it for now. You know, and then after Satan's last attempt, what he's going to do during the millennium is he's loosed after the 1,000 years of people living on earth and rebuilding the earth after the destruction of the worm of Armageddon and the Lord causing the new heaven and new earth to be created and people living on it and building on the earth for 1,000 years and there not being any sin or death. There's billions of people here. And by the end of that time, people are going to forget the New World Order. They're not going to have any memory of that. The children of the children of the children being born during that time, they're not going to have any real stark memory of the former Earth that their parents lived on. They're just going to hear stories of it. And so a lot of it will become, become complacent to it. Because when Satan's loosed, he's loosed after 1,000 years, he comes back to Earth and gathers up an army to go up against the Lord in Jerusalem once again. He does it again. You know, he doesn't learn first time, doesn't learn second time, and he's not going to learn third time. And so out of all those people that have been living during the millennial reign here on earth under a perfect rule, where the Lord rules himself and the Lord's people, his angels and believers and stuff, are helping him rule, he'll still manage to get enough people that will hate the Lord and try to usurp his authority again, you know, just like they did the first and the second time. And so that's squashed as well, you know. But it's just amazing. It's just amazing that he'll be able to find, you know, hundreds or even tens of thousands of people that would dare rebel against the Most High at the end of the 1,000-year reign. But they do. And so at that point, when he's cast into the lake of fire, there's going to be the great white throne judgment, and every person who's ever been born from the beginning of time until the end of time, at that time, when the end of the 1,000 years, will be judged. And I know that's one of the biggest things that the New Age totally negates from their teachings, and there's no accountability, and just spread light and love everybody, but they hate people who don't agree with them. They're all going to be judged out of the books, and you can read about that in Revelation. Great White Throne Judgment. I believe that's in chapter 19, chapter 20. And so, very interesting. And then they're all cast into the lake.